The Lord be with you. We welcome you here to Faith Lutheran Church on this Christ the King Sunday. It's the last festival day of the church year, a day when we come and honor Christ as our King. And so a special welcome to you on this day, a special welcome to our visitors as well. We're so thankful that you have chosen to join us. The radio broadcast today is from Kurt and Mona Jerpy in memory of Kurt's brother Kevin. And the flowers you see behind the altar are from Lynn and Margaret Splitgerber in honor of their 50th anniversary of membership here at Faith Lutheran Church. And so, congratulations. That is super. Incidentally, the new radio and flower sign-up boards are now posted out there on the kiosk. If you want to get a day already for 2024, now is your chance to do that. If you've not already done so, we do ask you grab those welcome pads located along the center aisle and sign them and send them down the way. Well, there are a lot of announcements today. It's a busy time of year, starting with a new round of Digging Deeper classes that begin today. The first one is the Prophesied Christ. It meets in the Faith Center and focuses on the Old Testament prophecies that pointed towards the Messiah. And then Advent Words meets in the upstairs conference room. It looks at some Bible Project videos focused on the four key Advent words. And so a couple good options. The Leading Worship Digging Deeper is off today. It'll resume next week. We encourage you to join us for Advent midweek worship starting this Wednesday. The theme for our midweek worships this year is the mystery of the Messiah. It's going to be, I think, a really enriching, beautiful time. Worship starts at 6:30 each Wednesday. But this week, you're going to want to come early for the annual Soup and Chili Supper. One of my favorite events of the year starts, I believe, at 5, runs up until worship time. We could still use some chilies and soups, and so if you've got a good recipe you'd like to share, there's a sign up for that as well. You'll also want to plan ahead to come early for the December 13th Advent service. That's going to be preceded by a wonderful dinner, catered meal, hosted by the Ringers of Faith, the Bell Choir. You can come and, as it says in the bulletin, come and dine so the bells can shine. This is a great fundraiser as we maintain our bells. Tickets for that event are going to be available starting tomorrow. There is a limited amount of tickets, and so those will be for sale tomorrow. There are a number of children's and youth ministry announcements. There's a lot happening for those age levels. The annual Happy Birthday Jesus Party is on December 10th. That not only is a fun time for the kids, but it's a little bit of a night out for the grown-ups, and so you can register for that online. And then Powerhouse had been rescheduled so that the football team could win state. Congratulations to them. The rescheduled date is coming up. It's December 15th. Registration for that is by the 8th. And then Faith is serving the high school free lunch this Thursday. And as always, we could use some helping hands for that as we get about 300 high schoolers over for free lunch and the Word of God. And so if you're able to help out on Thursday, let Kristen know. You're going to want to note again the financial snapshot in the bulletin. You'll notice that we are under 200,000, which is good news. And so let's just keep it up as we seek to end the year strong. There's a lot more to read about, including, you'll notice, the poinsettia order form insert in there. It's that time of year again. And then note the FLCW Christmas lunch that's coming up. You're going to want to get your ticket for that. But read through the rest of that on your own. As we continue, though, we're going to be singing that Great Christ the King hymn, Crown Him with Many Crowns. It should be noted that the hymn number is 170, not 405, 170. But as we sing that, let's rise and greet one another with the peace of Christ. Baptized into the death of Christ, we live in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. 1 John declares that if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Therefore, based on that promise, I invite you now, in a moment of silent reflection, to confess whatever sin or guilt is on your heart this day. Most merciful God, we confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his only Son to die for us, and for his sake forgives us all of our sins. Therefore, as a member with you of the priesthood of all believers, but by the authority of our Lord Jesus Christ, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all of your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. Our hymn of praise this morning is number 530, Jesus Shall Reign. You may be seated.
Thank you.
Please join me in the prayer of the day. Almighty and everlasting God, you have crowned your Son as King, and by his saving work will renew your whole creation. May the families of the earth that are now torn apart and held captive by sin find liberty in Christ and be subjected to his gentle rule. Grant this, we pray, through the same Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
The first lesson today is from the prophet Ezekiel, chapter 34, verses 11 through 16 and 20 through 24. This prophecy portrays the kings and people of Israel as a troublesome flock of sheep who have worked themselves into danger and harm. In response, God promises to rule over the flock directly and appoint for them a faithful shepherd from the line of King David, a promise that was fulfilled in the Good Shepherd, Jesus Christ. Reading from Ezekiel. For thus says the Lord God, I myself will search for my sheep and will seek them out, as shepherds seek out their flocks when they are among their scattered sheep. So I will seek out my sheep. I will rescue them from all the places to which they have been scattered on a day of clouds and thick darkness. I will bring them out from the peoples and gather them from the countries, and will bring them into their own land. And I will feed them on the mountains of Israel by the watercourses and all the inhabited parts of the land. I will feed them with good pasture, and the mountain heights of Israel shall be their pasture. There they shall lie down in the mountain heights of Israel, in their good grazing land, and they shall feed on rich pasture on the mountains of Israel. I myself will be the shepherd of my sheep, and I will make them lie down, says the Lord God. I will seek the lost, and I will bring back the strayed. I will bind up the injured, and I will strengthen the weak. But the fat and the strong I will destroy. I will feed them with justice. Therefore, thus says the Lord God to them, I myself will judge between the fat sheep and the lean sheep, because you pushed with flank and shoulder and butted at all the weak animals with your horns until you scattered them far and wide. I will save my flock, and they shall no longer be ravaged, and I will judge between sheep and sheep. I will set up over them one shepherd, my servant David, and he shall feed them. He shall feed them and be their shepherd, and I, the Lord, will be their God, and my servant David shall be prince among them. I, the Lord, have spoken. The word of the Lord. The second reading today is from 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 20 through 28. This reading comes from the great resurrection chapter of the New Testament, where St. Paul proclaims the reality and essential purpose of Jesus' resurrection from the dead. Now, note how this passage proceeds from Easter to the final completion of God's plan of salvation, when Christ the King has defeated all the powers of evil, including death. Reading from 1 Corinthians. But in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have died. For since death came through a human being, the resurrection of the dead has also come through a human being. For as all die in Adam, so all will be made alive in Christ. But each in his own order, Christ, the first fruits, then at his coming, those who belong to Christ. Then comes the end, when he hands over the kingdom to God the Father, after he has destroyed every ruler and every authority and power. For he must reign until he has put all his enemies under his feet. The last enemy to be destroyed is death. For God has put all things in subjection under his feet. But when it says all things are put in subjection, it is plain that this does not include the one who put all things in subjection under him. When all things are subjected to him, then the Son himself will also be subjected to the one who put all things in subjection under him, so that God may be all in all. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Now, of course, we invite the children to come up. Mackenzie has something special for you.
Good morning. Is it on? Good morning. Today is Christ the King Sunday, which means that we celebrate Jesus as our King. Can you tell me what makes a good king? Someone who's kind? All right. In the gospel today, we learn how the king separated the sheep from the goats, and he talks about how the sheep have been blessed because they were kind to the rejects of society. The goats were mean, so they got put in timeout. We don't talk about that. Now, we all know that Santa's on his way to town right now, right? Do you think that you're on the nice list? Be honest. Yeah, that's good, me too. With Christmas coming up, it's easy to get caught up in this thought that we have to do work to be on the nice list, when in reality, we don't deserve it, even if we try our best. But God knew us, and he knew we would mess up. So he sent his son Jesus to die on the cross to redeem and save his people. Jesus then rose from the grave, claiming his title as our king. He is the best king. He loves first, he is kind, and he is going to keep us safe on his list forever and ever. We have Jesus forever. Now can we pray? Okay. Thank you, Jesus, for always loving us and putting us on your nice list forever. Amen.
The Holy Gospel is from Matthew chapter 25. Beginning at verse 31. Jesus said, "When the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the angels with him, then he will sit on the throne of his glory. All the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate people one from another, as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. And he will put the sheep at his right hand and the goats at the left. Then the king will say to those at his right hand, 'Come, you that are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you welcomed me. I was naked, and you gave me clothing. I was sick, and you took care of me. I was in prison, and you visited me. Then the righteous will answer him, Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry and gave you food, or thirsty and gave you something to drink? And when was it that we saw you a stranger and welcomed you, or naked and gave you clothing? And when was it that we saw you sick or in prison and visited you? And the king will answer them, truly I tell you, just as you did it to one of the least of these who are members of my family, you did it to me. Then he will say to those at his left hand, you that are accursed, depart from me into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me no food. I was thirsty, and you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger, and you did not welcome me. Naked, and you did not give me clothing. Sick and in prison, and you did not visit me. Then they also will answer, Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry or thirsty or a stranger or naked or sick or in prison and did not take care of you? And he will answer them, truly I tell you, just as you did not do it to one of the least of these, you did not do it to me. And these will go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous into eternal life. The Gospel of the Lord. Please be seated. Dear friends in Christ, grace to you and peace from God our Heavenly Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. The Christ the King Festival that we're marking today is actually a very recent addition to the church calendar. It was first established only in 1925. And wasn't moved to the last Sunday of the church year until 1969. I mean, that really surprised me when I first learned it, because celebrating Christ as King is such an appropriate and obvious way to end the church year. I mean, after his resurrection, when Jesus gave his disciples the Great Commission, he declared, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me." We just heard St. Paul describe how God has put all things in subjection under Christ's feet until he has destroyed every other authority and power. I mean, the risen and living Jesus has ultimate authority over all things, not only at the last day or in heaven above, but already now and right here on earth. He is the King. And given that, today's gospel from Matthew 25 fits Christ the King Sunday perfectly. Jesus began by saying, when the Son of Man comes in his glory, which is a title he often used for himself. But then a bit later, he called that same figure the King, claiming his supreme rule over all creation. And then what follows is a final judgment on all the nations gathered before him. I mean, just as Christ the King marks the end of the church year, so this text marks the end of time as established by Christ the King. But that's where the obvious applicability of this powerful text ends. Because the actual meaning of this parable has never been entirely clear. I mean, last week I read five different commentaries on this text, and about the only source of agreement among them was it should not be read the way it so often is. You see, it's pretty natural to read it as Jesus' instructions for how we can enter the kingdom of God. I mean, we all need to care for people who are hungry, thirsty, strangers, naked, sick, and in prison. Because Jesus is out there incognito, checking on how we're doing. And if we fail, we'll be sent off with the goats into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. It all seems to make sense. Especially since those six acts of mercy that the king named are all vital ways to show God's love to the suffering. But no matter how obvious that reading of the text may seem, it's obviously wrong. First of all, because it reverses the clear witness of pretty much all the rest of the New Testament, which declares that God saves us by faith in Christ alone, not the good works that we do or fail to do. I mean, it's impossible to imagine that Jesus would conclude his public teaching by telling us to earn our way into the kingdom. But even on its own terms, the text doesn't support that interpretation. When the king addressed the sheep, he said, "Come, inherit the kingdom that was prepared for you from the foundation of the world." I mean, the kingdom is clearly not their reward for caring for people in need, but the fulfillment of a destiny God had long since decided for them. Moreover, the sheep were as completely surprised that they had been doing the king's work as the goats were that they had neglected it. As D.A. Carson notes, the reason for admission into the kingdom in this parable is more evidential than causative. That is, those acts of mercy only reveal who the sheep and goats are. They're not the criteria that decide their eternal future. But if the scholars agree on how not to read the text, there is no consensus on how it should be understood. I mean, are the nations gathered before the king all people? Or just the Gentiles? Or non-Christians? Does the least of these refer to everyone who is in need, or only Christians who are Jesus' brothers and sisters? Or maybe just to missionaries who are sent out among the nations? If the sheep are already designated as such from the foundation of the world, and the goats never had a chance, then why bother telling the parable at all, if nothing we do in response can make any difference? And if the acts of mercy that the king highlights are not the criteria for getting into the kingdom, why does it sound so much as if that is exactly the case? Well, as I read through those five commentaries looking for some insight, not only did each one present a different interpretation of what the parable really means, but they managed to discredit what the other commentaries said was the surefire meaning. By the time I got done, I was ready to call in sick and just let Pastor Dave handle this one today. But as I waded through that thicket of conflicting ideas, two conclusions did come into focus. One is a stark warning from our Lord, that Christ our King cares deeply for the poor and suffering in this world. In fact, he identifies with them so profoundly that as we care for them, we are at the same time caring for him. To express Christ's love for those in need is part and parcel of what it means to belong to him. I mean, that's why, as a church, we raise funds for hunger relief in November, support Common Cup Ministry in the food shelf, stock the blessing box, and serve community meals. It's why we make quilts and kits and bandages to send around the world, pack boxes for Operation Christmas Child, and visit people in the hospital, in jail, and in their homes. I mean, there's no calculation or mere sense of duty in all that. It's just what we do. Because such acts are so central to God's love that we dare not ignore or neglect them. At the very same time, though, the fact that such acts of mercy originate with Christ and not within us, that they express God's love for those in need, means that the final judgment on whether we enter the kingdom with the sheep or head into perdition with the goats cannot depend on whether or how we do them. The final judgment is real and inescapable, but that decision will not be based on our record. The gospel itself uncouples the call to be merciful from the fear of final judgment in the text. And that means that even as we heed Christ's call to be his hands and feet to our neighbors in need, we don't need to worry nor falsely hope that that will either put us among the sheep or the goats. For God has already made that decision for you. When you were baptized into Christ, he called you by name and made you a member of his kingdom. For Jesus' sake, God forgives you all your sin and clothes you with Christ's faith and righteousness. You are not included among the sheep because of your good works, but rather God sends you to do good works because he has added you to the flock over which Christ Jesus is the good shepherd. And that promise is finally the only solution to this complex text. You know, back in the heyday of radio dramas before TV took over, one of the most popular programs was called The Shadow. It centered on a mysterious, all-knowing narrator who discerned and frustrated evil plots. Each episode would begin by declaring, "Who knows what evil lurks in the hearts of men? The shadow knows." And each episode ended with the warning, "The weed of crime bears bitter fruit. Crime does not pay. The shadow knows." Well, when it comes to God's kingdom, to matters of judgment and salvation, to separating sheep from goats, our assurance and hope is that the shepherd knows. David Garland writes, "The Son of Man can tell the true nature of those gathered before the throne as easily as a shepherd can tell the difference between a sheep and a goat." And how? Well, because the sheep are those he has made his own, whose sin he has forgiven, whom he has named and claimed as blessed by my Father. And by Christ's own promise, those blessed ones include you and me. Christ the King is your King. And because he is, it means that you are free to get on with loving your neighbors as he has first loved you, in the joyful certainty that you will inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. There's no doubt about it, for the shepherd knows, and he knows you. In the name of Jesus, Amen.
I invite you to rise as we confess our Christian faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated as we continue to worship God with our tithes and offerings, and a special thanks to the Faith Singers for the gift of special music this morning. As we come to the prayers of the church this morning, there is one addition to what is printed on our blue insert. We pray for Eric Gerke, who was hospitalized this past week. Let us pray. O Lord Jesus Christ, our beautiful Savior, our good and gracious King, establish your rule in our world and in our lives. In your sovereignty, you have made us your own, pouring out your grace upon us in word and sacrament. And so now shine through us, that your gentle and merciful reign may reach even the least of these. Reign in our lives, reign through our lives. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Almighty God, we know that you always see us when we are in need. Make us always share in your loving presence and strengthen our faith in your loving kindness. We pray especially for those who are sick today, who are recovering, who are depressed, or who are grieving. Be with Keith Enstead and Eric Gerke, who were hospitalized this week. Be with all on our insert and those that we name silently before you now. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, Jesus said that whatever we do to those who are the least, we also do to him. Make us generous in our words, actions, and with our resources, that we would follow Jesus in loving discipleship all our days. Let us not look past those in need or neglect those who are suffering. Rather, let us give of ourselves and trust that God will use us to care for his people. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, as we move into the Advent season later this week, a time of full of traditions and significance for many families, draw us also to worship. May the message, music, and meaning of this time of year enrich our faith and empower our witness. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord of the church, continue to strengthen and preserve your church and bless congregations everywhere. As we continue to pray for Augustana District churches, we ask your blessings for Trinity Lutheran in Jeffers, Minnesota, and Trinity Lutheran in Kerrigan, North Dakota. We also give thanks for our sister congregation, Christ the King, as they celebrate their 60th anniversary. Bless Pastor Steve, Pastor Brian, their church staff and leadership, and all their members as they proclaim your word and shine your light. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Into your hands, Almighty God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your abundant mercy, through Jesus Christ, our Savior, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Our closing hymn is from the blue hymnal, number 801, Thine the Amen, Thine the Praise.
Thank you.
Go in peace, serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.